Hello, everyone. Hi, my boss is still taking a picture. I want to make a selfie with all of you. Come, Alexei. Raise your hands. Applause. Okay. So I'm Mark. I'm the maintainer of the Linux Kan framework and the drivers, and this is my colleague Alexei. And we will talk about SocketKan in the beginning, and then Alexei will focus on J1939. Now that you have a little bit of information about me, I want to know something about you. Please raise your hands. Who of you has used Kan before? Oh, nice. Just keep your hands up. Who has used it on the Linux mainline kernel? Okay, it's not getting less. Who has heard of J1939 before? Oh, quite, so many people. Who has used it on Linux? Some. And who of you have used the mainline Linux kernel stack? Me and my colleague, and one of my colleagues is cheating. Okay, I want to talk about first about Kan, that you all that we all on the same level. What's Kan about? Kan is a networking hardware and stack. It's you need just two wires for it. It's something different than Ethernet. It's much more simpler. This is why we have different constraints on Ethernet. The speeds are just up to 1 megabit per second. Yes, per second, just 1 megabit. And you only have 8 bytes of payload per frame. So, and a frame has these 8 bytes of payload and an addressing field that might be 11 or 29 bits. And based on that Kan ID, this is a priorization how to access the bus. It's like Black Friday shopping, only the strongest Kan ID wins. The Kan ID was the lowest number gets the bus, and all others, if they should send at the same time, they will automatically get away from the bus so that there would be no collision. And this means all the Kan frames, they are broadcasted so that everyone can receive them. How was the Kan infrastructure before we introduced it to the Linux kernel? You have the kernel, and because everyone thought, yeah, Kan is so simple, we don't need it in the kernel, we just have some library or whatever, and this is usually per vendor. Some vendor of hardware decided, we bundle some library with my Kan networking card, and we ship it to the user. So you have the protocol and everything in your application, and some other vendor sells a different networking card and a different library. And for example, tell your IT guys, when you switch your Intel NIC for an AMD NIC, you need to recompile your web server. Everyone says, what, are you crazy? And because of this, we decided, yeah, let's get the Kan stuff into the kernel, that you have a unified interface for all applications, just the usual socket, open, close, read, write, that you all know. So before it was in the kernel, you have no compatibility between all those different Kan implementations, no tooling, because everyone invented their own library, and there was resulting of this bad test coverage. And then we moved the protocol stack into the kernel. We can make use of the in-kernel infrastructure for drivers, for networking, and you open a socket, and this is your one and only interface between the kernel and your application. And some SOC vendors, they wrote their own drivers and brought their mainline, and for others, we did, and other people did, and so now you can use the same application for testing on your laptop with some USB adapter, or different, or the same application on your SOC with the internal CAN adapter. So this is how CAN looks now. You have different applications, the socket layer, the different protocols, then the networking core, packet scheduling, routing, and the CAN interfaces. This is how the flow of packets is in this. It's, it might look complicated in the end, but as an application developer, you just interface with the socket layer, and with the driver developer, you just at the bottom. So this is all quite nice and shiny. And with all this, we have a lot of infrastructure now, CAN utils for basic interacting with the CAN bus, and good examples to start with. We have CAN tests, we have Wireshark plugins, and so on and so on. Yeah, but coming back to the limitation of the CAN bus, packets are only, the CAN frames are only 0 to 8 bytes, and yeah, this is just single tiny spoon of data. And if you want to have, make a firmware update in your device or whatever, where the firmware is several megabytes big, several tens of megabytes, it's quite complicated. And for the CAN ID is not, in the lower levels, not standardized. What to do with it is just an ID. And what you do with it, if it's a sender or a receiver, or if it defines what the content of the packet is, it's up to you. So this is where J1939 comes into play. This all gives the teeny tiny CAN packets and the addressing meaning, and leverages the small, slow bus with the tiny packets to do something bigger. And this is where my colleague Alexei will take over, because he has cleaned up and implemented a lot of ideas and brought it into mainline. Oh no, I'm spoiling. Alexei.
So we already get some idea about challenges of CAN. It is slow, it provides, we can transfer really tiny bytes of data, and usually we have lots of choice what we can do, but well, it is, it provides us huge power to do really different designs, but how we work with this power, it depends on us, and sometimes we provide interfaces which are not compatible with each other. So here is the place where J99 and 1939 comes into play. Is it's providing it's providing a number of recommendations what you can do with all of this, and well, everyone is free to apply these recommendations, but if you do, your device will just work with another device. For example, we get recommendations for physical layer, and the main part of this specification is a number of different predefined PGNs. PGNs are parameter group numbers, and with this number you can already know how you can process all of data which are in the payload, independent on the way how you get it. This PGN is located in the CAN ID. The CAN ID is 29 bit. The data is 64 bit. And you get in CAN ID a source address, and you can even get a destination address inside of PGN. It depends on the PGN level, so until some PGN number you are able to use a destination address, and after this it's some kind of generic groups, like there's ID, for example, for engine status, I don't know, rotation temperature and so on. It's everything encoded and predefined inside of PGN. And well, we have three bits of prior and yeah, you can use it as you can, as you wish. As well, we get here a transport protocol, and some based on this, we get even extended transport protocol defined by ISOBUS. With transport protocol, we can more or less reliably send and receive data. It is not common in CAN, because usually you just fire and forget. And in this case, we have a handshaking request to send, request to request to send, clear to send, and end of message acknowledgement, which is done on after complete transfer was made. So between different MTUs, you are able to see if this data was actually transferred completely or not, and if not, then you are still able to somehow recover it. With transport protocol, you can send a message of 1,792 bytes, and with extended transport protocol, you can send a message of 112 megabytes. And this was a main challenging part of implementation in the kernel, because we need to provide abstraction layer for MTU, maximum transfer unit of 112 megabytes. Just a comparison of why we actually do not use some existing protocols. Theoretically, we would use IP with TCP or UDP headers, but, well, let's see. IP version 4, we have 20 bytes of header. It is even not fit to one CAN package. It is a lot. And with TCP, we have extra 20 bytes of header, TCP version 4. With UDP, we are close enough. We can put complete UDP header in one CAN package, but what can we do else with this? So we need it somehow. And here's where comes to use of this protocol and how can this be used in the Linux. Currently, this protocol is spread somehow, and there are different implementation in user space and different operation systems. So it closely the same situation like it was with socket CAN back in 2013 or so. Yeah. So, yeah, 2008. What kind of challenges we have with this protocol? Well, usually on a CASBAN, we work with like probably about 2,000 packages per second. It's not really huge amount of data for normal high power system. These packages are tiny, really small, so with SKBS, we have a huge overhead for each package. The specification provides relatively relaxed timing requirements, so usually we will not go to timeout if you are writing from user space with this stack implementation, but for example, on some low power system with, I don't know, old version of ARM with 400 megahertz, for example, IMX28, it will be problematic. There are user space implementations. In, you can spot a different variants in the wildness. There are kind of J9039 daemon running in user space and routing all the data to different applications. There's one library used by different applications or all-in-one application which is just doing everything. Or even you're probably familiar with this, some product is made by different developers or different companies at different time or status of development. So you get just different stacks on same product. In first case, well, it's possible to do this, but you'll get really long round trip times. So your CAN message will go to, will be processed by kernel, then it will be copied to user space and processed by J9039 stack or daemon. Then it will be somehow in some way, I don't know, pipes, Unix, domain sockets, TCP or whatever, transferred to the application. There's a huge amount of time and not needless overhead in this case. If you use a library, it will be easier for update or patch something, so your applications will be updated at the same time, but you'll get copy all the same data for each application. So for example, if you run 10 applications in user space, you'll get all these 2,000 packets per second for each application. It is needless overhead as well. All-in-one, well, it's possible to do this, but you'll get other kind of challenges, security, availability, and so on. Is it really good to manage a huge project all-in-one? I don't think so. And, well, I think this part is we don't really need to explain this. If you get different stacks, different kind of implementation on the same system, it's just a nightmare to manage this kind of project. So we have a kernel stack for J9039, and at least theoretically, it should cover four variants of this protocol. The original SIA J9039, ISOBUS, for this was needed extended transport protocol. Probably it should work on NMAR2000, it is for marine applications, and MILCAN is for military applications. We was testing mostly only first variant, but I don't think it will be a big challenge to extend or fix existing protocol to run with all other variants. So we have now the same well-known socket implementation from user space point of view. If you already worked with different kind of sockets, you will be able to apply your knowledge with this protocol as well. Kernel will give you all power you need to work with this stack and take some task over, for example, for address claiming and for transport protocols. So if you're starting to use transport protocol with J9039, kernel will gather all needed packages and assemble one huge data package and transfer it in one time to user space. For address claiming, you should do your own address claiming in user space, but kernel will cache these claims, and so you don't need to resend new address claims for each application, and this will save you some time on the bus as well. If you want to try to play with CAN, with a kernel stack, you can already use some examples in CAN utils. For example, JACD is a daemon for J1939 address claimant. It is really a straightforward, simple daemon, but it's ready for use. And JCAT was used only for transport and extended transport protocol testing. It is a similar kind like NETCAT, so you just get JCAT on both sides, on both units, and cut data from one unit, send it over CAN with transport protocol, and gather it on other side, so you can just put it like a file. For kernel, in kernel we have a documentation network, J1939 files, so you can read as much as possible from this. There are some examples, some motivation explanation. If you're missing some information in this file, please contact us or just send pages. Here's one example how you can implement a simple transfer in user space. You will need to provide a structure, SOC adder, with all needed information. You can use a name if you're already familiar with address claiming on J1939, then you know what name is. If you're not, the name is, with CAN ID, we have only one byte for address. And in some cases, it is not enough to identify what device it is. And name used as a 64-bit ID, so you can really pretty exact identify what device it is, what manufacturer, and so on. So at first stage, we claim this address, this 8-bit address, by sending a 64-bit name to the bus, and other applications then able to reuse this name to communicate with it. So you can use address directly or name. It is up to you. And you can use PGN as well, or you should, yeah. In this case, kernel implementation, we use source PGN differently as destination PGN. Destination PGN is used to compile a message which will be sent to the bus, and the source PGN is used as an input filter. So you can set it or not. If you will set this PGN on your source address, then you will get messages only for this PGN. As soon as you prepared your addresses for source and destination, then it's just enough to open socket, bind to it, and wish you can connect. If you do not use connect, then you won't be able to use send or receive. In these cases, you will need to use send message or receive message. In this example, I provided here connect, so we are able to use send. Here's an example, just proof of concept that it's working. On the right side is a Riot board with IMX6 solo. And here I am starting JCAT receiver. with address 90.0x90 and parameter minus R means that it is in receiver mode and all data will be redirected to TMPRX file. So I started here each top to show CPU load. On the left side, similar system, it is Riot board as well with same CPU. And here I am starting similar JKET application, but in send. Minus E means this input file which we use to transfer data. CAN zero, it is the interface which should be used to send data. So you can use multiple interfaces on your system. 0x80 is a source address and 0x90 is a destination address. Here you can see a status update. It was sent by the kernel over error queue. So you're able to use this, you should not use it. In some cases, it is really useful because, well, with this huge MTU, you just give the kernel huge amount of data and it start on processing. And well, if you need to know somehow in user space what is going on, you can request it. And proof that all the data was correctly transferred, I provided here a checksum on both sides. So it looks okay now. If you already familiar with J9039, there maybe will be, you'll spot here a bug. I just discovered this Friday. Can anyone see it? No, okay. There is a byte here. It should be different. It is size. This is a end of message acknowledgement message, and it should say I received so much bytes or so much packages. And well, in this case, it was wrongly implemented. And thanks to open source community, this bug was spotted and reported. It's just one example how it usually works. Main challenge with huge M2 was solved. One challenge is at least now is how to export the address claiming cache. Should we use some kind of similar procedure like with ARP cache? Currently, it's not really decided. I prefer to not mainline. Not ready implementation, so you can have enough time to decide what is good and then provide proper UIP for this. And well, we need some kind of test automation. I was playing with Osmocom, so maybe you'll go this way. I don't know if you already have some experience with this stack or with experience with testing for J9039. You are welcome, and I really would like to hear some suggestions and ideas. And well, it is already accepted for mainline. With kernel 5.4, you will be able to use it. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
So When you have these like 112 megabyte huge packets, do you pre-allocate buffers on the kernel level when you receive them? So do you have like this massive chunk of memory on your little embedded SoC, which is just wasted and ready for receiving these packets?
The implementation and protocol was designed so that not all systems are able to receive this amount of data. So we kindly ask first that we're trying to send a huge amount of data. Can you accept this? And other side can say, I can accept only this amount of data, or can say, I don't want this.
I see, thanks.
And for the sending part, we don't allocate this 112 megabytes inside the kernel again and don't copy it on block to the kernel, but we just use a socket memory and allocate from there, like how much is it, 128 Ks or so. Then we copy data to it, push it into the stack, and then the next allocation either sleeps because you have a blocking socket, and then it starts again if the driver has sent some data and frees some socket buffer, or if you are in a non-blocking mode, the sender process will return to the user space and say, I just have sent like 1 megabyte, and it's up to you to send the rest. And you have to provide the same or the remaining bytes of data into the kernel with another send or send to or whatever system call. And then the kernel picks up from there and completes or tries to complete until it blocks again or goes back into user space or a signal comes. And for the receiving side, it's, yeah, as Oleksiy explained, if so much memory is available, it will be allocated. We have no receive in chunks and provide to user space in chunks. We currently receive the complete 112 megabytes at a time and then provide it to the user space. For the receiving side, it wasn't that easy to do it in chunks, so we skip that for now. Any more questions? Yep.
Have you got any, how many drivers are currently in the kernel, and are people starting to look at actually implementing device drivers for these against your stack now?
This J1939 is based on the normal socket can as mainline since 2008, right? Yes, thank you. Since 2008, and there are many drivers inside the kernel now, and the normal socket can in raw mode without this J1939 is available and it's used everywhere, I think. And this stack is used on top of these existing drivers. One side note, the stack is designed in a way that the send packages and the receive packages are needed to be in the right order. If the send and receive packets get mixed up, the stack gets confused. So maybe your driver that's already in the kernel needs some tweaking. Another question?
Yes, hello. Yeah, first I would like to thank both Mark and Oleksiy to put some more things into the CAN network layer, because we really have two things. One is CAN network layer, which is in Linux netcan, and the other thing is really which is under Linux drivers netcan. So the drivers are really for SoCs and USB, whatever you have. So at least this increases the pressure for me to also bring my ISOTP mainline, which is just hanging around on my GitHub. But one question from my side, what about J1939 and CANFD? Is there also something, is there something which is going on to bring this also to KenFD, because it has not only 8 bytes, it has 64 bytes in the data of the Ken frame.
I think the problem with the SAE, that is the organization who does the standardization, all their standards are closed, or you have to pay money or something like this. But I've seen now that the next CAN protocol, like the CAN XL, is being implemented. Now the people from SAE are looking for CAN-FD and J1939. I think it's in the making, and I think there is a draft, but you probably can only download it if you're a member of the SAE. You cannot even buy it, as far as I know. Marek?
So how do you handle moving these big buffers between user space and the kernel? I know that the graphics stacks uses DMA buffs to kind of efficiently shuffle big buffers between user space and the kernel. Does the network stack have something similar? Or do you just like copy to user, copy from user?
For the sending path, we use the normal stuff from the networking stack. I think you can use zero copy. This is all abstracted by the networking stack. It makes the handling from user space a little bit more different, more difficult, because you say send and the send returns, but you are not allowed to discard the buffer because it's still in use. And if the kernel is done with it, then you get some message from the kernel that the buffer is done and you can discard it. The question was, is there a library that does this? It's inside the kernel, it's called zero copy. Look into documentation net and then look for zero copy. Use regex and then you will find something. there are examples in the kernel. Send file was the question, if we think about it. Do we have to implement a callback for this? I think we have to implement a callback for this. We should put it on our to-do list, yes.
The first stage, it was not really important. We had to provide at first stage some basic new API, which has no questions, so to say.
The well-established read-write, send, receive stuff, and all the optimization is on top.
Yep.
Another question? I think no one. Then thank you again.
Thank you.